Good morning, my brothers and sisters. I hope that this morning find you doing well. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. God has allowed us another opportunity to come together once again, maybe not physically, but virtually. And we just thank God for this opportunity. Even with everything going on, God is still good. God is still watching over us. God is still blessing us, and we just thank God for this. And we just continue to pray for those who are sick, those who are going through, the caretakers, those who are in mourning because of the loss of a loved one, and not just from COVID, but from anything, because life still goes on. Even in this pandemic, life is still happening. So we have to deal with all of this. But the main thing is we got to trust God. We got to trust God in all of this and through all of this. There is a word. There's a word this morning from the Lord. And we before we get into our word, we ask that you come and join us with a word of prayer. Dear Father, we come in the name of Jesus, thanking you for being so good to us. Thanking you for your grace and your mercy. Thanking you for looking beyond our faults and seeing our needs. Lord, we need a word. We need a word from on high. We thank you for what you've imparted, or what you've instructed us to do for today. Lord, we ask that you continue to bless and look over those and watch over those who are sick, those who are taking care of the sick, Father, those who are in bereavement. Comfort them and strengthen them in their time. Father, we pray that your people not only be hearers of the word, but be doers also. And we ask that you continue to bless your word, Father, and bless this ministry. Help us outreach and reach out to those who are lost and those who are weak and those who are strong and yet need encouragement. These and other blessings we ask in our son Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our word for today comes from the Gospel according to St. Luke. The Gospel according to St. Luke, and that 13th chapter, beginning at verse number 10. And it reads, "And he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. And behold, there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity 18 years, and was bowed together, and could in no wise lift up herself. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said unto her, Woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmities. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God." Amen. We'd like to speak to you from a thought today, loosed from your spiritual infirmities. Loosed from your spiritual infirmities. Amen. We've talked about this passage of scripture several times, and we like to get into it today and discuss some of the things dealing with our spiritual infirmities. Years ago in the late 90s, and early 2000s, T.D. Jakes had an annual conference that he would call women from all over the world to come to certain locations. And the name of the conference, or the focus of the conference, was to help women to release those things that they had suppressed and had inside of them that kept them from living out their full potential in the Lord. And these conferences were entitled, "Woman, Thou Art Loosed." He popularized this saying, and it's found in this Gospel of Luke. It was called, "Woman, Thou Art Loosed." And many thousands and 10,000s of women would attend these conferences and retreat. But I feel in my spirit that many of the thousands who attended may have missed what they should have received. A lot of folks attend events like this for more than one reason, more than seeking a word of deliverance. Some go there to network and to pass out their cards, trying to make a name for themselves. And some attend just to be able to say that they attended. They come back to their local churches and they want to brag or to gloat, saying that, you know, I was there, I went there. And then some go there in hopes to rub elbows with certain folks or to be able to see certain folks. And I believe that most of them leave spiritually the same way that they came. And people do church the same way. So many feel that they can come to church on Sundays or Wednesdays or whenever you have your midweek services, get a good feeling and make sure that the pastor see them. And then they leave the same way they came. Physically, they look like and they act like they had a breakthrough and something had occurred, deliverance had occurred. But, you know, they cried and they've shouted and they've slobbered all over the place and they danced all over the church and ran around the church and all of this. And it looks like everything was all right. And that's all well and good. But the danger is in what we don't see. Mm-hmm. See, Satan doesn't mind you shouting. Satan doesn't mind you dancing all over the church. He doesn't mind you crying. He doesn't mind you testifying and giving your testimony. He don't mind all of that, but don't you dare expose the infirmity in which he has bound you with. See, we know about cancer, we know about diabetes, and we know about heart disease and all such infirmities, but there are some infirmities that we keep hidden that are crippling us spiritually, and we can't release them with some kind of medicine prescribed by the doctor or drugs or chemotherapy or radiation therapy. There's got to be a higher power in order for these things to be taken away from us. Now, when we look at this woman in our text today, the Bible says she had a spirit of infirmity, and it was a spiritual thing that manifested itself in the physical realm. And it had her, the Bible said it had her bowed over or bowed over, or she was bent over. She couldn't look up. She couldn't use her hands. She didn't know where she was going. She could only look down and see where she was right then. That's significant because spiritual infirmities can change the way you look. They can change your attitude. They can change your personality. They can change the way you treat people. They can change your prayer life. The spiritual infirmities can change the way that you praise the Lord. So what do I mean? I keep talking about spiritual infirmities. So what do I mean by spiritual infirmities? Well, If we look at this term and we separate it, we look at each term separately. We look at infirmity first. Infirmity is a feebleness or it is a disease. It is a sickness. It's a weakness. And then when we look at spiritual is something that takes place on the inside. It takes place within the spirit. So when we talk about a spiritual infirmity, we're talking about a disease of the spirit. And a disease of the spirit, it is one that can't be diagnosed by any doctor on the earth. It can't be diagnosed by just anybody. It's one that's well hidden because it's in the spirit. Amen. 1 Corinthians 2 and 11, Paul says, "For what man knoweth the things of man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the spirit of God." A spiritual infirmity is one not easily recognized in saved folk. Let me say that again. A spiritual infirmity is one not easily recognized in saved folk. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying that even saved folk have some sin sick, have some sickness in their soul. Amen. Even saved folk have some stuff going on inside of them. They can suffer from spiritual infirmity. Stay with me for a little while and we're going to prove this. We're going to prove this. Amen. It can mask itself as dislike for sin or wrongdoing. But in reality, it's a spirit of hatred or dislike toward a person or a group of people. You can say that you dislike the way that a person is acting, but being real is not the way the person is acting. You really hate that person. And it's sad when supposedly mature Christians can't recognize the trick of the enemy. See, spiritual infirmities are tricks of Satan, which you feel like you are right, but yet he has this little disease growing in you, festering in you, and you don't even realize it. And the reason being is because it is a spirit. It's not something that you're doing outwardly, but it's something that you're hiding inside. Yeah. See, some of you are saying, well, you're not talking about me. So let's see. Am I talking about you? So let me give you a few examples of spiritual infirmities. And I'm going to give you a few examples and tell you what you need to do to get rid of these things. And then we're going to leave you in the hands of the Lord. Amen. Amen. So what are some of the spiritual infirmities in which we suffer from? First of all, let me give you an example of one: jealousy. And I know all of you have heard of jealousy, that green-eyed monster. Jealousy is a resentful of another's success or favor. There are folks who hate you because God's favor is on you. Oh yes, my brothers and sisters, I want to tell you there's some haters out there. Folks are hating on you because God has shown favor on you. And we talked about the favor of God, and we know the favor of God is not fair. Amen. Instead of glorying with you, or instead of praising God with you for the things that God is doing for you, they would rather hate on you. They have a problem with you because people around you seem drawn to you, or they want to talk to you and not to them. They have a problem with you because God is allowing you to prosper. They're the ones that sit back when God blesses you and you let folk know, and they want to sit back and say they think they're something, man. You know those folk, those people like that who hate you being blessed. I'm talking about the same folk who smile in your face and say, I'm with you, but at the same time in their spirit, they hate you. I'm talking about these folks who are jealous of you. They don't like the way you sing. They don't like the way you shout. They don't like the way you talk. They don't like the way you preach. They don't like the way you teach. They are jealous of you, but it's an infirmity on the inside of them. You can't see it, but it's there. But God knows it is a spiritual infirmity. So one of them is jealousy. Yeah. And it's in the church. Jealousy and envy, it's in the church. So what's another one? Another spiritual infirmity is pride. Pride is a strong feeling of self. It's a feeling of self-confidence and arrogance. It's confidence or achievement that you did it all by yourself. See, this spirit causes you to think that you're better than others. That's pride. It causes you to think that you're more spiritual than others. And all of us have met folk who think that they'll start talking about folks aren't on their level. They're more deep in the Lord than them. They don't deal with certain folk because I'm better than they are. I don't want you talking to me before service because it'll interrupt my spirit and I can't preach like these are people who are full of pride. It causes you to think that you got where you are on your own. This is pride. This is spiritual arrogance. We can shake hands, we can hug each other, we can smile at one another, but in some of our spirits, we feel that folks should be bowing down to us and recognizing us and show us all the respect because of who we think we are. This is a spiritual infirmity. This is pride. This is, I want you to look at me. I'm going to show out. I'm the center of attention, not Jesus, but when I sing my song, I want you to fall out and shout. When I preach my sermon, I want you to know and recognize it's me. Call me out by name. It's all me, me, me. That is a spiritual infirmity. We talk about jealousy. We're talking about pride. And what's another one? Woo. How about unforgiveness? Unforgiveness is a spiritual infirmity. Unforgiveness is the refusal to release or pardon another person of a fault or wrongdoing toward you or someone you love. See, and this is probably one of the most grave infirmities of the spirit. And some of us feel that we've arrived and we're where God wants us to be. But when a certain name is mentioned or when a certain group of people are spoken of, it causes anger to swell up in us or to rise up in us. And if that happens, there's some unforgiveness somewhere. Some of us have separated ways from folk and we can't talk to them. We can't stand to see them. When they enter the room, our whole spirit goes black. Our facial expressions change because of unforgiveness in our heart. And I know the old saying is you got to forgive and forget. But that saying is not true because you're always going to remember what somebody done to you. You're always going to remember if somebody hurt you and especially hurt you deeply. You're always going to remember that you can't forget it. But when they say forget means it doesn't hurt you anymore. It doesn't mess up your spirit anymore. It doesn't cause you to change into another person anymore. That's what forgetting means. It's going to be there because sometimes people will scar you. And when you look at that scar, you know where it comes from. But it doesn't hurt anymore. Amen. So many Christians have this infirmity. And it's plagued them for years. They walk upright in the physical, but in the spirit, they're bowed down. They're bowed over. And because of this, they can't go beyond where they are. Like we were talking about the woman. She couldn't look up. She couldn't look where she was going. She can only look where she was because she had a spirit of infirmity and she was bowed over. And these people can't reach any higher. They can't see any further. They can't grow any larger from the point where they are because of unforgiveness in their heart. Amen. Because of unforgiveness. You have jealousy. You have pride. You have unforgiveness. And there's others, but for the sake of time, I want to just mention them. So how can we be loosed from these spirits or our spiritual infirmities? Well, I'm glad you asked. I'm going to tell you. There are three ways. There are three things that you have to do. There's three things that you have to do, and you have to do them in sequence. You have to do them in order. First thing you have to do, you have to allow yourself to be in the presence of Jesus. See, you can't be concerned about how you look or who sees you. A lot of folk won't be delivered, and they can't be delivered. They can't be set free because they worry about how other folks are going to look at them. They're going to look at them. If you don't hold a grudge on somebody, what's wrong with you? You mean you're going to let them go? You're going to let them? Yes, you're going to have to do this. You got to recognize, or you got to realize that you need a cure. You can't be listening to what all these other folks are saying. You can't worry about how you're going to look. If it takes exposing yourself that you have a bent over spirit, you need to do it. If it takes allowing people to see that you're not all of that and a bag of chips, you need to do it. If it takes you losing your identity, who they think you are, you need to do it because you need a cure. So the first thing you need to do, you need to allow yourself to come into the presence of Jesus. Stop hiding behind your title. Stop hiding behind the name that you think you have. Stop hiding behind your money. Stop hiding behind your prestige or your status. Stop hiding and come out and expose yourself into the presence of the Lord. Jesus wants you to come out. So stop hiding. The second thing, when you allow yourself into the presence of the Lord, the second thing, you need to hear his voice. When you come into the presence of the Lord, you need to hear what he has to tell you. See, this woman was in the crowd in the synagogue bent over. She was in the crowd in the synagogue bent over, but Jesus called her out. Amen. She didn't see him, but she could hear him. And I know that other voices have comforted her over the years. These 18 years she was bent down. I know they've comforted her. I know they ministered to her. But when Jesus spoke to her, it was like no other voice. I heard Jesus say in John 10 and 27, he said, "My sheep hear my voice. And I know them and they follow me." And many of us listening today, many of you listening today, you need to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the church.
Jesus is talking to us. The Lord is talking to us, and we need to listen to what the voice is telling. Don't think that the word is for everybody else, but you got to know that the word is especially for you. Don't say that, that word for them, but you better do some soul searching yourself and make sure that you're getting everything that the word has for you. So you need to come into his presence. And when you come into his presence, you need to hear what thus said the Lord. And the third thing that you need to do, you need to feel his virtue. You need to feel his virtue. Because the Bible says, for example, there was a woman that had an issue of blood for 12 long years and she wasn't cured. She wasn't cured. Amen. Doctors touched her. Doctors worked on her. She spent all of her money, but still there was no cure. But the Bible says that she heard that Jesus was passing by. And when she joined the gathering throng, she did not worry about her issue. She did not worry about what they said about her. She did not worry about how she looked. But when she got to Jesus, the Bible said that she touched the hem of his garment. And Jesus said, somebody touched me. And the disciples said, Lord, everybody touched. He said, This was a different kind of touch because virtue left my body. And when virtue left him, he turned and he saw the woman. And the Bible says that when she touched him, it said that the blood dried up. Yes, that's right. The blood dried up. And Jesus looked at her and said, by your faith, thou art made whole. And now we look at this woman who had an infirmity for 18 long years. And doctors done touched her and tried to help her, tried to bend her up, but still straighten her up. But still, they could do nothing. They did all of this and it was no good. But when Jesus touched her. When Jesus touched her, it was a touch like no other touch. On Wednesday night, I talked about the touch of God. And once you're touched by the Lord, you'll never be the same. When Jesus touched this woman, when she came into his presence, when she heard his voice, and he touched her and said, woman, thou art loose. The Bible says that she straightened up immediately. She straightened up and she was loosed from her infirmity. I don't know about you, but somebody out there, they need a touch from the Lord today. They've been spiritually bound for so long, they can't grow any higher. They can't move forward because they're spiritually bound. And we need a touch from the Lord, because a touch from the Lord, the Bible tells us that the leper was cleansed by the touch of the Lord. The dumb can talk by the touch of the Lord. The deaf could hear by the touch of the Lord. The lame could walk by the touch of the Lord. The dead was rising by the touch of the Lord. Amen. The Lord's touch woke us up this morning. The Lord's touch allowed us to see another day. The Lord's touch closed us in our right mind. The Lord's touch caused us to move about in our bodies this morning. The Lord's touch can loose us from all of our spiritual infirmities. Amen. Just a touch from the Lord can loose us from all of the mess that we have on the inside. And I'm not talking about the people out there in the world, but I'm talking about the people who call themselves Christians, people who have said, I'm living for the Lord now. Jesus can relieve us or release us from all of this mess, this jealousy and envy, this pride that we have, this unforgiveness that's in our heart. He can release us from all of this, this lust, this greed, all of this stuff inside of us, but we need a touch from the Lord. He is the only one who can loose us from our spiritual infirmities. Amen. Amen. I don't know about you, but every day I have to check myself to make sure I'm not jealous of somebody else, wanting to be them or desiring what they have or hating because of what they, I have to check myself. Amen. Every day I have to make sure that I know that I'm not all that in a bag of chips. I still got mess in me. Every day I have to make sure that because you did this or because you did that, I'm not holding a grudge. And it's all because by the mercy of God that gives me the mind, or should give us the mind, to look at us before we start pointing at somebody else.
Judgmentalism is a spiritual infirmity that a lot of us got. We just think we being saved, how many people we done sent to hell thinking that we Jesus and we got hell in us. Oh, I know I'm talking to somebody. Y'all don't like me now, but I know I'm talking to somebody. Spiritual infirmities. Amen. Amen. We hope that we've said something that have been encouraging to you, that have been enlightening to you. Looking within ourselves at the spiritual infirmities that we have, and also knowing the solution to get loosed from our spiritual infirmities. And we thank God for y'all tuning in today to the channel, and thanking you for your continued support of this ministry. We thank God for the support. Thank God for y'all sharing on Facebook. I don't think I had an account a while ago, and amen, but I don't know. I still may get one to put this out another avenue. Hopefully we'll be going back in the house soon, but I don't want to stop this part of the ministry. And we pray that God should give us insight on what we need to do with that. Amen. And I just thank God for all of you supporting financially. We're really blessed yesterday, and we ask that you continue to do what we're supposed to do in the Lord. You can't beat God giving. I don't care how much you try. You can't beat God giving, and God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. And if you're mailing it in, continue to mail. You can mail your cards, contributions, whatever. We just thank God for you staying in touch with us. That address is Mississippi Baptist Church, Post Office Box 1275, Baxley, Georgia, 31515. That's Mississippi Baptist Church, Post Office Box 1275, Baxley, Georgia, 31515. Amen. I got to get out of here, but I want to encourage you to continue to pray for one another, pray for our sick, pray for those in bereavement. Continue to do that. We need prayer. If at any time we ever needed prayer, we need prayer now. Amen. Continue to pray for our leadership. Crazy stuff is going on. If you look at the news, crazy stuff is going on. That means you got to stay on your knees. Pray, pray, pray. Pray for our leadership. Amen. Corona is still out there. The numbers seem like they were going away at one time, but they're getting back up there again. People getting crazy, not wearing masks and stuff like that. But when you go out, you be safe. Wear your mask. Wear your mask, people. Wear your mask. Wash your hands and watch your distance still. I know they cut down distance some, but you wear your mask. Do those three W's like we were talking about. Amen. I love you. I'm getting out of here. I love you. Enjoy the rest of your day or whenever you're listening to this. And know that I love you. I care about you. Continue to pray for me as well. Have a great day and take care.